Yeah, just a bit of personal background. I'm a third generation vegetarian. My all four grandparents, three of my eight great grandparents were a vegetarian. My grandmother apparently became a vegetarian at the age of five when her family pet rabbit, she learned it was destined for the pot. Very sad. One of my earliest memories, and I think this rather parallels Brian's, I used to, probably around at the age of four or five, I used to rescue worms that were in danger of being drying out on the tarmac, rescued little ants that cruel boys had trodden on, and also I recall seeing a blackbird taking a worm out of the ground and taking it away, and I clapped my hands so that yes, the blackbird would be scared and drop the worm, but of course then I was thinking in my little 5-year-old way, well, if the blackbird doesn't eat, then the blackbird and her babies will starve. And of course at that kind of age one can't start thinking about kind of re-engineering the global ecosystem, reprogramming predators, that kind of ambitious stuff like that. The problem seems technically insoluble to me. Flashing forward a bit to my teens, I suppose I was quite a melancholic, depressive, introspective teenager, thought quite a lot about suffering and how to get rid of it. Stumbled across the work of Olds and Milner on the pleasure centres, or as they were then called, and how that it seemed that raw pleasure or raw bliss did not show any physiological tolerance. An intracranially self-stimulating rat or human would continue to press away indefinitely. Now, clearly that wasn't a long-term solution to the problem of suffering. It wouldn't be sustainable. There would be strong long-term selection pressure against wireheads, and the only people who tend to find wireheading an attractive prospect are the severely depressed. Likewise, drugs, although in principle we can imagine a future of designer drugs. Nonetheless, drugs have well-known pitfalls. All today's recreational drugs just tend to kick the brain's negative feedback mechanisms into gear. Didn't seem a long-term solution. And my own preferred solution for getting rid of suffering in humans and eventually throughout the living world is to edit our own genetic source code. And one of the advantages for a start, for example, of recalibrating the hedonic treadmill, and this very much touches on what Brian was saying earlier about compromise, that if your hedonic set point can be radically elevated, it's not necessary for you to sacrifice many of your existing values and beliefs and preference architecture. That, to use a very trite example, I star my music collection for 1 in 5. If my hedonic set point were radically elevated, I might star it from 95 to 100, but I would still prefer one category of music to another. And if with the impending reproductive revolution of so-called designer babies, when we bring new life into the world, we choose such things as high pain thresholds for our future children, and also a high hedonic set point, it will be possible to ratchet up individual levels of well-being without actually asking people to compromise their existing values. Anyway, that's getting ahead a bit, just a bit of more autobiography. Even though I could understand how it was going to be feasible for humans, at least in principle, to phase out suffering, I couldn't understand how if at all it was going to be possible for non-human animals, sort of deep marine ecosystems, for suffering to be abolished there. But then I read Drexler, The Engines of Creation, and about molecular and nanotechnology. And though Drexler doesn't focus on suffering, yes, that was to me the final piece of the jigsaw. Back in late 1990, I always assumed that my ideas would be sort of unpublishable, but yeah, then came the internet, the World Wide Web. Back in late in 1995, I wrote an online manifesto, The Hedonistic Imperative, which essentially argues for, yes, phasing out all experience below hedonic zero in our forward light cone, and both advocates and predicts a future in which intelligent sentient beings live lives of intelligent bliss that is ultimately going to be orders of magnitude richer than anything physiologically possible today. Now, okay, that is extremely speculative. As a negative utilitarian, I think we have an overriding moral obligation to phase out involuntary suffering. But unlike Brian, I'm quite optimistic that a few centuries hence, there is not going to be any experience below hedonic zero in the world. And the question is, what are we going to do then? Anyway, back in 1997, a fellow by the name of Nick Bostrom, who was then a postgrad at the LSE, dropped me an email with a couple of very sharp questions about HI. We met up and shortly afterwards set up the World Transhumanist Association, which is now Humanity Plus. Rebranding exercise. Now, I confess I was initially quite sceptical about the prospects of setting up something like this. I associated transhumanism with extropianism and very kind of libertarian current on the west coast of America, but Nick persuaded me, and yeah, we set up the WTA. There are clearly many aspects to transhumanism. I mean, I would identify the three supers of super intelligence, super longevity, and super happiness. And it's fair to say that many transhumanists are not especially focused on the issue of suffering, let alone wild or free living animal suffering or animal rights, that for them it's a detail. But nonetheless, yes, the Transhumanist Declaration does commit us to the well-being of all sentients. And if one takes this commitment seriously, then yes, the implications are very far-reaching. Okay, now as I said, I will scroll through some of these slides, but as I said, the reason I'm here today is not to speechify and give you a talk. I really wanted to hear more about the effective altruist community here in Switzerland and your ideas on the route forward. I also would be very keen to explore differences as well as similarities with Brian's work, because I think the whole issue of consensus building is extremely important in that if, for example, phasing out involuntary suffering depended on converting the world to negative utilitarianism, it's not going to happen. But if we can build bridges and establish some kind of global consensus that phasing out the biology of suffering is a good thing, then I think this is the best way forward. So what I'm going to do is just scroll through this. Yes, I mean, clearly the idea of getting rid of suffering, there is nothing... I'm being steered to move left. There is nothing new about the idea that we should get rid of suffering. It's central to Buddhism and Jainism, What is really different is, for the first time, the technology exists to see how it might be feasible, that one can construct some kind of blueprint to how it might happen. I think, and this is this directly ties into what everyone can do today, by far the greatest source of severe and readily avoidable suffering in the world today is factory farming, and so I think our urgent priority should be shutting down factory farms and slaughterhouses, quitting eating meat product, and make it clear that animal abuse is as unacceptable as child abuse, and that if you think that a pig, for example, is as sentient and, for what it's worth, as sapient as a two-year-old child, pre-linguistic toddler. If we were doing to pre-linguistic toddlers what we're doing to pigs, no one would seriously question that it's the most urgent issue. But of course, most people will just instinctively rebel at any kind of equation like this. This just outlines the challenges that we face to phasing out suffering for life on Earth. These challenges will be orders of magnitude more formidable if Darwinian ecosystems have evolved elsewhere in our Hubble volume. But for various reasons, I'm actually personally quite skeptical that Darwinian life does exist elsewhere within our cosmological horizon. So I don't think cosmic rescue missions probably will be necessary, but I could be wrong. This is very, very tentative at this stage. Physical pain, clearly it does have this information signalling. Now, the young man he suffered sadly from congenital analgesia. It's a rare syndrome. He unfortunately jumped off a high building to impress his friends and died at the age of 14. People who have no capacity whatsoever to experience phenomenal pain, it's clearly genetically maladaptive. So how does one deal with this problem? The hedonic treadmill. The hedonic treadmill can be good or bad. Around about half of people with locked-in syndrome, for instance, who can communicate merely by blinking, describe themselves as happy. And now compare what percentage of normal, healthy people in the world today describe themselves as happy. Probably slightly more would do so. But it's tremendously powerful, this homeostatic set of mechanisms in the brain, and once again on the African savanna it was highly adaptive for us to be discontented a lot of the time, to be worried, to be jealous, all this kind of suite of Darwinian emotions. And most people have this very powerful intuitive conviction that if we were to re-engineer the world socially, a fairer, more compassionate, caring, socially just world, then this would solve most of our fundamental problems. Unfortunately, this doesn't seem to be the case. There is a great deal of evidence that hedonic set point has a very high degree of genetic loading. And even if we lived in whatever your version of the ideal society is, there is sadly a lot of evidence that there will be immense suffering still in the Garden of Eden, whether, you know, just mundane stuff such as existential angst, jealousy over, you know, sort of rejection and so on. Ultimately, if we want to get rid of suffering, it's going to involve biological genetic solutions. But yes, there's a lot more that could be said about the hedonic treadmill. Factory farming. Unfortunately, as we know, moral argument can only go so far, that many people will accept in the abstract that a pig is of comparable sentience and sapience to a pre-linguistic toddler, but they'll shrug and say, but I like the taste of meat, and if pushed, they will then say something like, but a pig doesn't have the potential to be a mature adult human. But of course, we recognise that essentially a small child who's never going to live to see his or her third birthday needs more care and protection, not less. Right now, billions of non-human animals are suffering so we can gratify our appetites. And yes, this is an immense problem. What about obligate carnivores? This might seem to be an insuperable problem too. If we want to preserve cats and other carnivores in some form, surely it's inevitable that they have to eat mice. You suggest to anyone that they might need to give up their beloved pet cat, and they will react very badly indeed. This might seem an insuperable challenge. Wild animal suffering or free living animal suffering. Someone like Richard Dawkins would claim that it is as a matter of necessity, that there is simply no way that we can get rid of animal suffering. Just an obvious example, one might imagine that in a time of famine in winter, for example, that we should be going out and feeding starving herbivores. In practice, something like that would just cause more suffering, because there's then a population explosion and followed by ecological collapse. As I said, I think this is technically soluble, but that is the nature of the challenge. That's just an example of one particular gene, the SCN9A gene. Nonsense mutations, congenital analgesia, other mutations, either a very high or a very low pain threshold. And once again, though one can envisage young children a very high pain threshold, it might seem an impossible challenge getting rid of pain altogether because of its functional role. Just to run through the challenges and how they can in principle be solved, and here we come to more practical stuff. Brian quite rightly was saying that even if we are strict negative utilitarians, it is extremely unproductive to start thinking about Armageddon, sterilizing life. It's not going to happen. It will alienate people. If we want to phase out suffering, we have to take part in the messy business of making a better world. And much more controversial, should one bring new life, new suffering into the world? One thing that is now technically possible to do, and this is prior to any future era of true designer babies or genetic engineering, before actually deciding to have children, we can use pre-implantation genetic screening to actually choose such things as the level of pain sensitivity of our future offspring. And quite basic, it makes sense to, for example, choose a benign allele of the SCN9A gene. And even today, there are people with extremely high pain thresholds for whom pain is just a useful signaling mechanism. And that if we want to, we can engineer, naturally inverted commas, a world in which our children and grandchildren do not suffer the horrors of physical pain. I say horrors, and hopefully everyone in this room is feeling comfortable right now. But yeah, next time, I hope it doesn't happen, that you are struck down by severe pain, it really is just shocking how dreadful it can be. So yes, physical pain, it will be possible to render it trivial. I can come into how it will be possible to abolish it altogether later. Yes, if we want to abolish physical pain altogether, there are two options, not mutually exclusive. One would be to have essentially simply information-sensitive gradients of bodily well-being. An example here would be two people making love from start to finish. If done well, it's extremely pleasurable, but nonetheless, there are certain aspects of lovemaking that are even more pleasurable than others. And so in that sense, it would be possible to have information-sensitive gradients of well-being. But the other and perhaps more elegant way to do it would be to have smart prostheses such that, for example, one withdraws one's hand before it actually hits the hot stove with a presumably a manual override, so one doesn't feel one has lost control of one's body. Yes, that's just the what I mentioned about wire heading. Even though it is one technical way one could phase out suffering, it's not actually feasible because there would be selection pressure against wire heads. So this is the idea of just uniform bliss. Technically speaking, activation of the mesolimbic dopamine system doesn't induce pure opiate-like contentment or bliss. It's more a frenzy of desire. It seems that the motivational axis, the mesolimbic dopamine system, and the pleasure axis, kind of activation of your mu opioid receptors and our twin hedonic hotspots, they are dissociable. And in future, in principle, it's going to be possible to arbitrarily amplify one or the other. But this, as I said, though useful as a kind of existence proof for people who are sceptical it's possible to be perpetually happy, is not a sociologically or evolutionarily plausible future scenario. Yes, a vast amount could be said about drugs, both clinical drugs and recreational drugs. The main problem with recreational drugs is that they can make one feel wonderful for a few hours and then there is a crash. Yes, we can imagine that various forms of supersoma or designer drugs that don't have the pitfalls of today's agents, but there's a more fundamental question. Wouldn't it be much better if our default state of consciousness was such that we weren't so keen to change it? And so I think in the long run, although there may conceivably be a place for drugs to give fine-tuned control, I think we really ought to be aiming for a scenario in which we are all born for physical and psychological super health, invincible super health. So I'm going to click yes. And okay, this to some people it's still sci-fi, and the issue of the nature of selection pressure in a world where there is this reproductive revolution of designer babies is still not properly explored. But you simply just ask yourself, if you were choosing now to have a child, yes, you could use today's genetic crapshoot, or you could choose, for example, a variant of the COMPS gene that's associated with a high hedonic set point. Which would you choose? Other things being equal, it seems highly likely that most prospective parents, including prospective parents who care about many things other than happiness, i.e. they want their children to be winners, are going to choose benign versions. So probably, assuming that the reproductive of revolution of designer babies does gather momentum, there is going to be immense selection pressure in favour of more benign genes. But many, many things could go wrong here, and perhaps later we can tackle some of the pitfalls. Yes, I mentioned the comp gene. The comp gene has, this is, okay, this is extremely simplistic, but just for one example, comp gene has two alleles, sorry, catechol-O-methyltransferase gene. One is associated with a high hedonic set point, predisposition to have many enjoyable, rewarding experiences. The other variant is associated with a low hedonic set point. And other things being equal, if you're going to have a child, I would say it makes sense to choose the benign option. Once again, much more could be said there. The issue of non-human animal suffering in our factory farms, should we be prioritising ethical, moral argument, persuading the world to go vegan now, or should we be pursuing a twin-track approach that involves in vitro cultured meat? I think we should do both. Some animal advocates would disagree, but if you're pessimistic, as I am, about the power of moral argument on its own to unleash an ethical revolution, I think we do need to pursue the twin-track approach. What on earth can we do about obligate carnivores? Well, this actually ties into the in vitro meat issue that millions of people, hundreds of millions of people, there's no way they're going to give up their beloved cat. But there is no reason in principle why one can't give the catnip laced in vitro meat. We can already devise mincemeat if, and it's a big if, that one can persuade people that the suffering of small rodents and the like actually ethically matters. There's no need even to genetically re-engineer cats, genetically tweak them. One could use this kind of solution. Once again, I think the fundamental problem is ethical, ideological, or well, combined with simple status quo bias, that most people would not see the plight of birds or mice that cat molest as something that's ethically troubling. Yes, wild animal suffering. I think, yeah, a lot of us, like, you know, one enjoys nature, wildlife documentaries. It's good going out in the country, in the countryside. But nature is fundamentally extraordinarily cruel. And if one says that one wants to phase out free living animal suffering, most people will assume that you're simply ecologically illiterate, that you don't understand the second law of thermodynamics or the notion of a food chain and trophic levels. What we can do, as I said, if, and it's a big if, we decide that we do want to phase out suffering in nature. Two options in one, in a sense. One can simply do habitat destruction, which we're doing effectively at the moment, and effectively wipe out nature in her existing form. And it's quite likely that there aren't going to be any free-living, non-human terrestrial vertebrates in the wild by the middle of this century at this rate. So essentially, it's going to be a case of what kinds of life form do we want to exist in our future wildlife parks? And if we do want to preserve recognisable approximation of the so-called charismatic megafauna that many people are so fond of, including lions and tigers and the like, then, yep, there are ways to tackle this. It's a technical problem with a technical solution. Genetic tweaking, immunocontraception, fertility regulation is the easiest and straightforward. We could do it right now. I said it doesn't involve any radical form of futurist speculation or anything like that. Most people's reaction initially is this is sci-fi, but within the next few decades, every cubic meter of the planet is going to be computationally accessible to surveillance, micromanagement, and control for good or ill. So we're going to have to decide essentially what kinds of sentience we want to exist on the planet. Yes, that's the URL there discusses some of the practicalities if we do decide to reprogram existing carnivores. The future. This is, I've been talking about suffering in the biosphere, and I was sort of originally talking and discussing these issues at the end of the last century. Even this, most people would regard as pretty crazy stuff, but events have moved on. More and more futurists are discussing the future of life in the cosmos, and yes, we will need to be thinking about what we're going to do over the next few billions, tens of billions, even hundreds of billions of years. Now, in my original meta-narrative, I imagined that it was likely that humans are going to phase out suffering on Earth, and then, yes, galactic radiation spreading life that was based on, as I said, information-sensitive gradients of bliss. But it is also possible to imagine much darker scenarios, the kind of the scenario that Brian was touching on. Already there have been entirely theoretical blueprints for colonizing other solar systems. It would require theoretical breakthroughs in technology we don't have, but at the moment, clearly, if we were to launch a 100-year starship or the kind of thing the Pentagon had been mooting, yes, one would be creating Darwinian ecosystems elsewhere rather than focusing on getting rid of suffering. Clearly, yeah, there's vast. I've skimmed over so many issues, but yeah, I think this would be a very good time to open up the discussion. I'd be very interested to hear what people think I could be doing most effectively to help you and collaborate. I said I hope that we're going to be exploring some of the tensions between my work and Brian's work, because I think, as I said, I think consensus building is really important. Some people would regard it as just a sign of intellectual flabbiness, but on the contrary, I think actually taking the movement forward is going to involve these kinds of reaching out and compromise, even with religious people who might, you know, one might sort of totally opposed to this high-tech stuff. If one, yeah, cites, you know, the Bible, how the Garden of Eden was vegetarian, the lion lying down with the lamb, Jesus, miracles, the loaves and the fishes prefiguring in vitro meat. If one really wants to, one can. After all, what would an all-compassionate, all-merciful being want us to do? If mere mortals can envisage the well-being of all sentience, it seems blasphemous to suggest the Almighty or Allah or whatnot is going to be more stunted in the range of his affection. So yes, I wouldn't, if at all possible, alienate some of the very largest constituencies in the world today. Clearly there are some groups that unfortunately there is just simply no way one can have a constructive dialogue. But simply because someone is a Christian, for instance, it doesn't mean to say that one should blank them out. Okay. Okay.
Do you have thoughts on the most important practical things that people can do, like activists or people who are working on concrete causes rather than just research or writing?
Yeah, I touched on the issue of vegetarianism, veganism, quitting meat. I mean, clearly one is, one worries, could I do more good than harm? But I think, you know, that if we are going to make this transition from a society that is based on exploiting sentient beings to a society that is based on helping them, this very, very basic start is, to, if one isn't already, to become vegetarian and then vegan oneself, and urge others to do likewise. Yes, I mean, I do think the issue of free animal suffering is extremely important, but it seems highly unlikely at the moment that we could do anything that could compete with the 1% of habitat destruction each year. Just in general, before one can actively start helping sentient beings, one needs to stop harming them. And that is, a very basic thing. In terms of, you know, kind of wider issues, you said that there are all sorts of stuff we haven't, you know, touched on, like sort of climatology. One needs to think where one can personally make the most effective contribution, and clearly people vary here. So I would say what is most going to be most cost effective for the individual is not that there's a one size fits all approach.
What would you spend your $1 million on right now?
What would I spend my $1 million on? Given my own design limitations and knowing what I am capable of, I would probably, for example, get more stuff translated into other languages. With an audience all of whom are fluent English speakers, this might not seem especially urgent. But whether it's Chinese or other languages, these ideas may be odd to many English people, but they are completely alien to, for example, Chinese people. And even if the minority of Chinese people who do have a smattering of English, nonetheless, if you really want to win people over, you really need to address them in their own native tongue. And so, a strong native language translations is one thing I would do. I would also have a kind of Wikipedia strategy too, even though people pay lip service about it's only Wikipedia in practice. We all do it. You're not an expert on the subject. First thing you'll probably do is you go to Wikipedia, you know, you mug someone up or an organization up. I would probably use a Wikipedia strategy. As I said, it's a matter of working within one's own design limitations. If I had higher testosterone count, if I were more psychologically robust, I would get much more intimately involved in the organisation building. I think organisation building is critically important. It's a real force multiplier. I'm not, as we know, organisation building involves formidable challenges. A lot of the time can be quite thankless, you know, a lot of the bureaucratic organizational stuff, but it needs to be done.
If you could build up a movement of people who care about whatever you like, what would you like them to care most of? So for example, the EA movement has been focusing mainly on poverty. There's an animal rights movement mainly focusing on animal rights and veganism. There's a transhumanist movement focusing on transhumanism. So what would you favor, or where? What do you think is most important? What sort of movement?
Yes, I mean, for example, poverty, there's a lot of evidence that, yes, interventions, at least in the Western sphere, within the bottom 10%, 10 or 20% of the population, can make a difference. But from then on, any impact is marginal. And it's extremely, perhaps, cruel to suggest that as long as there are still people in absolute poverty, I mean, if your child is starving or something like that, then talk about recalibrating the hedonic treadmill is going to seem very remote and philosophical. But in the long run, I think we are going to solve, I say long run, in the medium run, we're going to solve the problem of poverty. And I think a priority now would be making the switch from natural, i.e. blind genetic crapshoot of sexual reproduction, to making sure that pre-implantation genetic screening is offered to all prospective parents throughout
the world. As we know, the cost is crashing, both of sequencing your own genome and pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. I think campaigning this for this to be the norm. It's particularly with a German-speaking audience, one needs to be very careful because sooner or later someone is going to mention the E word of eugenics. Yeah, not all cultures, obviously, have got the European experience there. In practice, many, if not most people, if you ask them, should we preserve the cystic fibrosis allele, will say, no, don't be absurd. But equally, they'll say they don't support eugenics. I think it's important to stress the extent to which, for example, depression, which has a very high degree of genetic loading, can be just as devastating for quality of life as something like cystic fibrosis. Of the million or so people who kill themselves each year, they tend not to be people with severe genetic disorders like cystic fibrosis. They tend to be depressives. That would be whether it's in one's own life, if one is going to have children, making sure that, yes, one doesn't use the traditional genetic crapshoot, but also campaigning, not just in the first world, but in the third world, for routine pre-implantation genetic screening. In practice, it's actually used most commonly in India and China for gender selection purposes, but what we want to do is to extend this for rather more worthy goals than gender selection, I think.
Just briefly, you mentioned depression. What are your thoughts on the possibility that there might be fewer altruists, and maybe more specifically fewer negative-leaning altruists in the world if we eradicate depression?
Yes, it's possible. On the other hand, there's so much evidence that on the whole, suffering doesn't tend to ennoble. It embitters. And as we understand more about the workings of the CNS, one can sort of understand more about the basis of empathy, empathetic understanding. And in principle, too, we can, yes, choose alleles and allelic combinations that predispose to greater empathy as well as to enriched mood. We need to be very careful here. Julian Subelescu's talked about the imperative of moral enhancement, and yes, the idea that we might choose to have children who are morally, naturally more advanced than today's quasi-sociopaths. But equally, there's a lot of evidence too that the ability to behave in ways that we would regard as ethical depend on this capacity for impartial rule following, and the kinds of people who seem to be most capable of impartial rule following are people who are quite high on the autistic higher AQ scale. Now, what would be ideal is if we could switch cognitive styles as appropriate from being, you know, this kind of empathetic, sensitive, mind-reading to, in other circumstances, impartial rule following. But it's extremely difficult, and it's implausible, perhaps, that we can start, re-engineering the genome with moral enhancement in mind. Yet, I think there are too many imponderables, an immense imponderable, probably goes without saying, is that there is as yet no consensus on moral values. Unlike Brian, I do incline to value realism. I think there's this controversial opinion that the pain-pleasure axis does disclose the world's intrinsic metric of value and disvalue, and that the fundamental reasons why we behave so badly to each other are epistemological limitations. Essentially, that on the African savanna, it was extremely genetically adaptive for genes to program organisms, and within one's world simulation, you are the center of the world, your kith and kin are most important, and this profound epistemological limitation, and that if we really did have perfect knowledge, of each other's first person perspectives, then harming another sentient being would be akin to harming oneself. I mean, think of mirror touch synesthetes. But as I said, this is a controversial view. It seems to be in conflict with Hume's guillotine, but I think one can make this kind of case that our behaving badly is a function of ignorance. It's not perhaps necessary to argue for altruism in the strict sense. If one does have this kind of God's eye view of the world delivered by science, then one can argue that essentially it's a constraint on rationality that one doesn't privilege some here and nows over others. And that, sure, my pain is real, and I can only, in a sense, theoretically grasp the distress of others, but this isn't some deep metaphysical truth about the world. It's simply a function of my own limitations. And one of the good aspects of technology is that it's highly likely later this century and beyond that there are going to be technologies of reversible mind melding, so that, yes, it will be possible for you to enter into the perspective of other people, whether it is your girlfriend or boyfriend, or in theory, members of other species too. And it's also rather neatly solves the philosopher's problem of other minds. And if, and it's a big if, these technologies do become ubiquitous, I think it is going to lead to a radical revision in our conception of decision theoretic rationality. Standardly, the canons of decision theoretic rationality are individualistic, but this might lead to a more collectivist conception of decision theoretic rationality.
Do you expect a singleton, that is a single level of highest authority, to help constrain evolutionary pressures? Or if not, wouldn't evolutionary pressures potentially invalidate a lot of the hedonistic imperative ideals, because the organisms that reproduce the best would win rather than the ones that have the highest happiness?
I think if we do move to the reproductive revolution, the nature of selection pressure changes, and genes or variant alleles that in the ancestral environment of blind natural selection based on sort of random mutations will actually be at a disadvantage. In terms of selection pressure, I think the big change is going to come when we move to a society that is phasing out involuntary aging, in which case I think there are going to have to be international agreements on when it isn't feasible to have a child, and the various sci-fi scenarios that say that if you want to have another child you'll need to go to Alpha Centauri or something like that don't have a lot of political, sociological or technological credibility. As long as there is death and aging, it seems as though that world population is probably going to stabilize around 10 or 12 billion people. But if later this century radical anti-aging becomes the norm, I don't think we should kid ourselves. All of the ideological opposition we see today is going to melt away. Their use is going to be near ubiquitous. One needs to see the way a new anti-wrinkle cream is cleared out of the local chemist if it's introduced. It will no longer be possible to have procreative freedom as we understand it today. And clearly there are immense totalitarian implications there if we start having the state presuming to control either the female reproductive tract or its analogue in males and so on. In principle, of course, it's possible to control one's desire to have offspring, but how many people will want to intervene in this way? The nature of selection pressure later this century and beyond, I can't know, But nonetheless, once it becomes technically trivial, not merely for one's offspring, but also for oneself to start redesigning one's own genetic source code, and when you can choose one, you know, your hedonic range, the upper and lower bounds of your hedonic experience and average hedonic set point, there doesn't seem to be any constitutional advantage of being in an unpleasant state of consciousness. It seems to be very much a contingent feature of organic biological robots that, you know, these phenomenally nasty states like jealousy or phenomenal pain occur, that, at least to the best of our knowledge today, that we can replicate functional analogues, for example, of jealousy. There doesn't seem to be any particular reason to engineer jealousy, the functional state of jealousy in a silicon robot, but we could do so if we wanted to. Do we imagine that jealousy is going to somehow switch on? I don't think so, any more than it's likely that the nociceptive function that we've already implemented in silicon robots is going to be accompanied by a phenomenal pain. It doesn't seem to add anything extra. So I don't think, yeah, but back to your original thing, that there is any computationally, functionally indispensable role that phenomenally nasty experience plays, that by its very nature is going to give organisms that possess it some kind of reproductive advantage. That it's interesting today that some of the people, I often use his example with express permission, someone like Anders Sandberg, who is a brilliant academic, he's at the Future of Humanity Institute. He will describe himself, he has an extremely high hedonic set point, but he is working in the field of existential risk. Simply because one has a very high hedonic set point doesn't mean to say that one is going to be relaxed. One can even have the functional analogues of paranoia. Indeed, it can be argued that the more you love your life, the more motivated you are to preserve it. Much more needs to be said.
I'm interested in you two discussing your respective concepts of consciousness.
I can say of it, yes, the hard problem of consciousness, if the fundamental constituents of the world are as modern science seems to suggest, then we ought to be zombies. By rights, it shouldn't even be the case that it's all dark inside, that you and I should be having this. The laws of physics would apparently be the same if you and I was up here talking and you were listening, but yeah, there's no phenomenal experience whatsoever. Why isn't this the case? Yes, how we answer this question is the hard problem of consciousness. My own account is, yeah, there are two angles to it, both of which are extremely controversial. One is that it seems that, yes, that the equations of physics, or utopian physics, tomorrow's physics, do exhaustively describe the behaviour of the stuff of the world. There is no element of reality that is absent from the fundamental field theoretic equations and their solutions. But nonetheless, physics doesn't actually describe the intrinsic nature of the stuff, the fire in the equations. And this would seem to be up for grabs. Even an arch materialist like Stephen Hawking will say we have no idea what breathes fire into the equations. And in theoretical physics, something like a field, for example, is defined purely mathematically. And so if you're, as I am, what one sometimes calls a Strawsonian physicist, one has this conjecture that, yes, the fundamental constituents of the world, the fire in the equation, is itself some form of primordial consciousness or what its likeness. Now, this might sound extremely fanciful, but it's perhaps worth considering the one part of the world that one does have access to as it is in itself, so to speak, and not at one's remove, not at one remove, and that is one's own mind brain. And as the phenomenology of our consciousness attests, yes, the intrinsic nature is radically different from what one's materialist intuitions might suppose. I mean, Kant notoriously said that we will never know the intrinsic nature of the stuff of the world. All we know is phenomenology. But Schopenhauer, and following Schopenhauer, Russell, Michael Lockwood, Strawson and others point out, as I said, that there is one part of the world, the noumenal essence of the world, that perhaps one does know as it is in oneself, and it is conscious. The second, and this is is probably most controversial though, is simply hypothesizing that the fundamental stuff of the world might be consciousness in its primitive primordial form doesn't really solve the hard problem, because if one is scientifically literate, one is not going to be an animist. Chairs, tables, mountains, or I would say digital computers, are not subjects of experience, nor are you in a dreamless sleep. And this is what is known as the binding problem, or the phenomenal binding problem. How is it that apparently, at least in organic robots, discrete quasi-classical entities like neurons, when they're, let's say, processing edges, textures, motions, and the like, how is it that the, what really ought to be, if you take Strawsonian physicalism seriously, just structured aggregates of classical mind dust, how is it that, at least fleetingly, they come together into bound phenomenal objects, populating a unitary experiential field apprehended or instantiated by a unitary self? This seems to be classically impossible. I personally believe a quantum mind. I think that what seems to be the mind-independent world is a simulation that your mind brain is running at perhaps 10 to the power 10, 12 or 13 quantum coherent frames a second. I don't expect many people to buy this, but it's a falsifiable hypothesis that when we can actually probe the mind brain at this extraordinarily fine-grained temporal resolutions, instead of finding mere noise, as one might assume that one is actually going to be able to recover the formal structural analogues of the phenomenology, the macroscopic objects of one's world simulation. It's this structural mismatch between the kind of the brain and the phenomenology of our minds that pushes David Chalmers into his naturalistic dualism. Some scientists, scientifically inclined philosophers like Daniel Dennett, bite the bullet. They recognise that consciousness is impossible within a materialist framework, so therefore they deny that they are conscious, or you are conscious. All the options are extremely implausible. So the question is, which one are we going to go for? As I said, philosophers are not supposed to make falsifiable predictions, but this is one I would make. We're not actually going to find noise when we can probe the brain at this kind of level. As I said, Brian does believe, or takes very seriously, the prospect of digital sentience, and my own views on the nature of risk would change if my own view here would be confounded.
What's your probability that you're wrong? I'm sorry, now maybe this changed the subject again, but
It's because it's very, very difficult to how does one factor in these things. I tend to assume I am wrong in most things, but I don't think I am wrong and the person I disagree with are right. I think we are both likely to share some false presupposition or background assumption. I could very well be wrong here. When are we going to know? When, Brian, would you regard as a kind of credible timescale, given what we know of Moore's law and so on, when one would expect classical digital computers
to start exhibiting what would normally be construed as the science of sentience.
I don't have specific time predictions, but it seems plausible within the century we could have robots that we can converse with, or at least that show animal level behaviors. We already have robots that show the behaviors of small animals, like insects and so on. So I expect there could eventually be robots that we can talk with and talk about their emotions with, and they would tell us how they feel. And
One very strong presumptive evidence would be if our silicon robot started spontaneously requesting anesthesia before one did bodywork repairs and painkillers and the like. It's not difficult even now to, you know, before switching off one's PC, it emits a distress vocalization and pleads not to be shut down. This isn't a question of passing the Turing test or anything like that. So I wouldn't buy into some kind of behavioral criterion.
Well, there's also mind melding as well. We could potentially mind meld.
Yeah, that's true.
So my view of consciousness is roughly similar to Dennett's, although I don't think that denying consciousness is the right way to describe it. It's rather that consciousness is implemented in an algorithm in your brain, and so that's all you need to have. So the idea that physical operations don't suffice to explain consciousness doesn't make sense, because what else would there be that's doing this? So there could be the dualist explanation that there's some other mysterious mind thing that's causing the consciousness, but either the mind thing is totally separate from matter, in which case it's not clear why you need it. Why not just have matter do this, generate the consciousness? That would be a simpler explanation. Or if it is part of the material world, then it's not really dualism after all, it's just some sort of extra physics. But even with extra physics, it's not clear why you need some special physical property. Why not just have ordinary physics that we know give rise to the consciousness? When you think about what consciousness is, it's some sequence of steps that your brain is taking, and we can implement that theoretically with digital computers or with neurons in the brain. I'd like to suggest that people think about what's happening in their brains, or even a so-called philosophical zombie's brain, when it thinks to itself, wow, I'm conscious, this is what it feels like to be me. That's some sequence of physical operations, even in the zombie brain. And so that is one of the things that we call consciousness, that those kinds of operations of self-awareness and reflecting on yourself and self-modeling and all those things are physical processes that computers could do that zombies would be doing. And we don't need anything more, because that's what's going on. Any thought that you have that's going on in your brain is traceable as a series of neural operations. So that's enough. And like, for anything that you can be doing, think of what's happening in the zombie brain. Why can't that be consciousness? Consciousness is the series of operations we usually associate it with. Like self-aware consciousness is some sort of self-model and thinking about your own thoughts and so on. There can also be just kind of awareness of emotions, and there are various models for that, what that might look like in terms of like making signals aware to the rest of the brain. Daniel Dennett has a model of consciousness as being like fame, where things are conscious when they become more famous. In other words, more parts of the brain are informed with the news of what's going on. If consciousness is a class of operations like this, and in fact it involves many different operations that we might care about to different degrees, then you can think of consciousness as a class of algorithms, or some sort of fuzzy set of algorithms, or like a category into which we classify minds. And so some minds have this property, some more than others. Consciousness isn't even necessarily binary in this sense.
So do you see this binding problem as well? So would you, I mean, if there was a computer which, for instance, in one module it processes sort of the color of things, and in the other the shape or the movement or something, and there's no module where it's all brought together, would you then consider this as conscious of this ball, for instance, or, as long as it has certain behavioral manifestations that we have when we see this ball? Or would you agree that there's something more that has to be done?
I personally would call it conscious, although it's up to you where you want to draw the lines. I think the binding problem is an easy problem, like all the other problems of consciousness, not in the sense that I can solve them, but in the sense that they will be solved by ordinary science, and they only require ordinary science to explain them. So with the binding, for example, you can think of that being done by a neural network, where like you've got lower level inputs that detect the edges and the colors and so on, and then those are combined as features for a jar classifier or a table classifier. And so then the higher level nodes in the network encapsulate these higher level concepts and so on. So, I mean, that's one example of how you could solve the binding problem relatively simply. It's just a classification in the brain, and then our higher level picture is a series of these higher level concepts, like we have a jar node and a table node, or these higher level properties. And so that's another plausible way that it can be done. In general, if you have some complex physics that does the binding, it's plausible you could imagine some simpler neuronal network that creates the same kind of process.
What is your position?
Just a couple of points. First, I said what I'm calling Strawsonian physicalism, which sounds a lot more austere than panpsychism or something like that. It's not a conjecture about something dualistic. It's a hypothesis about the intrinsic nature of the physical. I mean, most of us probably naively assume that we have some kind of handle on the nature of the physical, but unless we're direct realists about perception and think we can directly apprehend material objects, or unless we think that physics really does disclose the intrinsic nature of a 10-dimensional superstring or a brain or something like that, then we don't naively know what the physical is. And the Strawsonian physicalist says, yes, physics, or rather tomorrow's physics, is formally complete, i.e. there isn't anything missing from the formalism, there are no hidden variables or anything like that, but the intrinsic nature of the physical is different from what we suppose. Binding, again, once again, I would hope ideally to work out some form of testable conjecture that we can actually falsify. And Eric, how do you pronounce his name? Schwitzenbuhl? It's rude not pronouncing people's names correctly, but he's basically, his title of his paper is "If Materialism is True, the United States is Probably Conscious." And in one sense, I think he's absolutely right to face up to the challenge that the materialist confronts. And though I don't think one can definitively rule out the possibility that United States is conscious, is a subject of experience, a unitary subject of experience, it's inconsistent with reductive physicalism. And this is the point. If we're going to give up reductive physicalism and the ontological unity of science, then all bets are off. We can, in principle, although probably most of us would say the USA isn't conscious, one could arrange an experiment, if population cooperated, of 300 million skull-bound American minds communicating via electromagnetic signals rather than chemical neurotransmitters, and functionally replicating a mind-brain, and see if at some stage, by some physically unknown process, that both local and global binding switches on. Local by individual cross-modally matched phenomenal objects, global meaning a unitary subject, a unitary field of perception. Now, as I said, I would strongly predict that this isn't going to occur, that all one will have would be 300 million very closely interconnected and communicating skull-bound American mind brains. But yeah, as I said, I think one should be looking for testable predictions and experiments.
and the advantage, however implausible it sounds, of quantum coherence as an explanation of binding is that, at least in principle, it's falsifiable.
My opinion on the United States example, if it was running the right sorts of algorithms, I think the United States would be conscious along with the individual citizens. I mean, binding or the sense of unity in self is itself a construction of the mind, and there's certain algorithms that create this sense of unity. So if you run those, then you get this sense of unity as being implemented. And there's no reason that you have to have just one level of consciousness. I mean, that consciousness is a class of operations, and you can have operations within operations within operations. So there's not really confusion there. It's just like saying that you can have big objects that contain small objects that contain small objects.
Yes, some people, Nick Bostrom would be one of them, and I think Brian, think that conscious subjects of experience can exist at multiple levels of computation and abstraction, whereas I don't think ultimately reality itself contains any levels, and if one thinks consciousness is fundamental, essentially that one couldn't have layers of abstraction with unitary subjects of experience in the way that... as distinct from the way in which a computer one does have these multiple layers of computational abstraction. Yes, the implications for effective altruism of our respective views on consciousness. It would be very pessimistic, well, on some views it would be optimistic, that essentially this issue is going to be solved within, it would take 100 years, you would say, or is that just, do you think?
Well, it's primarily a philosophical problem. I think as computers become more sophisticated and we understand neuroscience better, fewer people will maintain the intuition that they don't explain consciousness by themselves. But it's more of a fundamental philosophical issue.
One understands a phenomenon in the physical world when one reduces it to something basic, you know, just like life originally seemed to involve radically different principles from the non-living world, but eventually, you know, it was sort of explained by non-equilibrium thermodynamics, and even though in principle today one can't, in practice today one can't explain information-bearing self-replicating DNA in terms of string theory or anything like that, nonetheless, in principle, one understands how to, you know, reduce molecular biology to quantum chemistry, chemistry to physics, and ultimately physics, perhaps speculatively, to M theory or whatnot. But nonetheless, one can map out how, in principle, it can be done. But in the case of consciousness of any kind, if the materialist intuitions about the nature of matter and energy are correct, then yeah, we should be zombies.
Well, I think this is just an intuition where we disagree. Maybe generational turnover will change it more than anything else. But if you have the intuition that material operations, no matter how much they map onto the algorithms explaining the sense of self and all, but if you have the intuition that that still doesn't explain it, then you just have an assumption that that I don't hold. There is a parallel case with free will, for example. Some people, no matter how much they understand a deterministic machine selecting among options based on the evaluation of the potential payoffs, they still insist that there's something to free will that's not explained by that way of thinking about it. And so that's just an intuition. That intuition itself can be explained by sufficient neuroscience. Elias Rudkowski has a proposal in which humans have tend to think in Platonic terms, where they think of the fundamental essence of the thing when it's actually just a classification category. So they think of the question: is it really conscious? Must have like a true binary answer? When in fact they're just talking about what properties does it have and how is it running? And it's kind of a messy cluster in think space, as he says. There's no real answer. Is it really a thing? It's just you're describing various properties of the thing. And so the same is true for consciousness or free will or whatever. We can say everything that there is about free will, but people still wonder, do we really have free will or not? Because they think there's something extra that needs to be asked.
I still wonder, I mean, for instance, let's say we invent these robots that can police nature and make sure that no animals get hurt. Would you be willing to send them out there and you would oppose them? Oppose it because you think they are conscious themselves and they suffer and you not so?
It's, well, in my case, it's kind of reconciling what I think is technically feasible with what I think is sociologically credible. And probably most people, they would, even if they have terrible lives in some cases, would be sort of life-loving. And it tends to be the life-lovers, I think, who are going to triumph. And I think it's likely that we will, say we loosely, will go and colonize the galaxy, so it may not be possible to impose this kind of hermetically sealed solar system. But if it is the case we are going to do so, I think we want to make sure there are safeguards in place such that there is no experience below hedonic zero. And I think in technical terms at least this would be very relatively straightforward to do. Sociologically this is much more speculative. Although today we know there are all manner of different forms of suffering, the actual roots of suffering seem to be extraordinarily primitive in the limbic system, not our complicated neocortex. Brian is more pessimistic than me.
Yeah, as far as the robots, so there would be concerns about the robots potentially suffering. I think, well, first of all, there would be many fewer robots, presumably, than, say, insects, so it might be worth it. But even beyond that, you can presumably design the robots to have some sort of gradients of bliss. I think pure gradients of bliss may be hard for agents that act in the world, because negative reinforcement is a very useful thing to have to avoid bad outcomes, like getting trapped or like dying or whatever. And I mean, there's a reason that organisms evolve suffering and not just gradients of bliss.
This is what I don't understand in your position. How can there be, I mean, how would you decide whether this robot has gradients of bliss or whether it has like something below hedonic zero and something above? So I don't really see how with you.
To some extent, it's a value judgment that you have to make. Because, yeah, as you say, like, you, depending where you set the zero point, it can either be positive or negative, or it can be all above zero. I think, for example, David Pearce's instances of people who are very happy, like, we can say that even though they have these gradients, we feel that that's better than somebody who's depressed and has gradients. So there are other components of their brains that are relevant here, so we might decide that certain operations that are involved with these motivation and being aware of your motivations and motivational updates, some of them are like more humane than others. So there could be higher level texture to how we evaluate these things. And I think it's not just about like numerical comparisons for reinforcement, although that is relevant.
Do you have a formal, some kind of more precise way of what is this other thing that enters? Some ideas on this? I mean, we don't have to discuss it here, but have you written something?
No, not in detail. I don't know enough to say, but we can say whatever it is that is going on in happy humans is the more humane version. As far as the other part of the robots, so you could imagine more humane kind of gradients, although I still think they would suffer to some extent. And as far as the feasibility, I'm not sure about that either. I think it's a good thing to propose in the sense that it doesn't step on other people's values too much, and it's it doesn't turn many people against your cause. Potentially feasible, probably more likely is people will decide just that they don't care about wildlife so much, or maybe they'll preserve it, and that'll be a small loss for suffering. I'm not sure people will invest the resources to do fine-grained robotic control of nature relative to other things they wouldn't want to do.
Yes, and people's intuitions are inconsistent, and in that last year there was a wildlife documentary involved starving elephants, and the switchboards were jammed with people ringing and complaining that the camera crew didn't intervene to save the baby elephant that was starving to death, and people were indignant. And of course, they're right to be indignant, but at the same time, if one talks about re-engineering nature, high-tech Jainism, compassionate conservation, and so on, people will think it's some wild, crazy scheme. But this surveillance society, we're used to thinking of global surveillance and sort of the NSA and the Snowden revelations as absolutely terrible, but profound privacy implications, shocking in some senses. But in another sense, it means that whether it's a baby elephant or ultimately even a small bird or insect expiring or being in distress is not going to be something that is invisible as it mostly is today. So there's going to be much greater immediacy of the dramas of life on Earth to most people. I mean, just take today's zoos, for example. Zoos, most of them have scrapped out feeding live rodents to snakes because people who visited thought it was barbaric and uncivilized. But exactly the same degree of intimacy and immediacy and radical transparency is going to be feasible in tomorrow's wildlife parks. And although most people, a lot of the time, including sadly most of us, may be callous, we're not on the whole malicious. And because of this greater intimacy, I'm cautiously optimistic that people won't want to see baby elephants starving or zebras being asphyxiated or stuff like that.